The Arizona Coyotes have a new coach, probably a new direction here as well. Mike Johnson does a lot of work for TSN, the NHL Network, former player, former Coyote. Mike, how about that, right? Let's bring in, talk about the Arizona Coyotes for this season. It's a lot of new. They traded out a lot of guys that were there, some staples, Oliver Ekman-Larsson gone to Vancouver. What do you make big picture here right now with what the Arizona Coyotes are as we look at them on paper heading into training camp?
Well, I mean, I think what they are is one of the worst teams in the league, but that's by design.
Yeah.
And that's okay. Like, you know, they were stuck in the middle. They went for it. They were a capped out team. They tried to acquire veteran guys and make a run. It didn't work. So what you don't want to do in any professional sport is get stuck in the middle, be just okay to make it or just okay to miss and never really draft highly. And so they said, you know what, that's not going to work. Let's strip it down. And boy, did they ever. Bill Armstrong got to work. Yes. He recognized he needed draft picks because they didn't have some because of some penalties and some trades. And so they have so many draft picks coming up in the next 2, 3, 4 years that they'll be able to rebuild, replenish the cupboards, hopefully get a really high pick and eventually become good again 3, 4 years down the road. That's an appropriate plan. But Dan, that's also the easiest part of this. Like tearing it down is not hard. Building it back up properly with good players that you can afford is much more difficult, but they've kind of accomplished the first half of it, stripping it way down. They're not going to be great on the ice, but that's okay because they're trying to build for the future.
Yeah. I mean, look, Darcy Kemper's gone, Antti Raanta's gone. So their goaltending changes out, right? They found, you know, a trading partner for Christian Dvorak with the Montreal Canadiens, who were looking for a center after losing Jesperi Kotkaniemi in the offer sheet, which I, by the way, tangent, love that, okay, from the Carolina Hurricanes. But regardless, but they still have Clayton Keller. They still have Nick Schmaltz. Phil Kessel is still there. Like, they have to still be able to put a team on the ice and be competitive, even if it's not to make the playoffs this season. And I think this season, while we're looking at them and saying their future, you know, it's all about the future draft picks and all that, we need to see Clayton Keller take ownership here. We need to see Nick Schmaltz take ownership. Is it still too soon for them to do it? I mean, Ekman-Larsson's not there anymore, so there's leadership openings. Is it still too soon for these guys to take ownership of this team and make it theirs as they build or, you know, continue to build around them?
I don't know if it's too soon. Might be too much to ask. Yeah. I mean, I think if I'm going to I'll look to Jacob Chychrun and say that guy will fill the void of leadership and be the kind of, you know, the anchor that will direct the organization and the guys. I mean, Clayton Keller has to take strides, become more consistent, become better. But, you know, at some point you can do that off the ice, certainly become a leader in the room and all those things. But, you know, I'm not sure if he's a guy who can go out there by himself without a ton of support around him on a bad team and kind of elevate everyone else just yet. And I'm not sure he'll ever become that, but that's where, you know, Schmaltz and Keller, who are really good players. I love them on my team, but I don't know if I, at this point in their careers, I can say you two are the lead dogs. You got taken on every night and be the difference makers. I don't know if they're that now. I don't know if they're that ever, but as far as leadership goes without Ekman-Larsson, some of the other veterans gone, Chalmerson retiring, Jacob Chychrun, I think there is the foundational piece that you really want to move forward for. You can look at him and say, that's our guy.
And he's a guy that they put out there publicly too, a lot for different appearances and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So they recognize that as well. I mean, if you're a player here, your GM and is basically it's stripping it down and saying, look, we know we're not going to be that good. How does that land on a player who's been there for a little bit? You know, I mean, what's the feeling there? Is there motivation to say, you know what, this is my career now. I got to do something with this. Or is it like, okay, I understand that. We'll be patient.
Well, I mean, if you're Clayton Keller and you got a big long contract, you're like, okay, I get it. You know, I mean, we're going to hang in there. And if you're a player who maybe doesn't have that, and it's kind of tough to say, but listen, I played on some tough teams. And if you want to become more in your career, you want to have a bigger role, you want to make more money, you want to play for Arizona. There is opportunity there to be had. And you could parlay that on a bad team into a good year and a very different looking future. So you can spin it within the team concept, but also look at it individually. There'll be chance to get ice time, points, whatever it might be in Arizona this year that might not be there for other teams. Yeah. And that's where, you know, you'd be you'd get good positive motivation. Now, if you're a veteran player and you're Phil Kessel, it lands a little hollow. Like, he doesn't want to be on the worst team in the league, right? Yeah. Like, even though he's like, you want to be competitive, you want to try to win. You're at that point in your career. It's not about money. It's not about a comp. Like, you just want to try to win and have fun, because as we all know, when you don't, it's awful. Like, being a professional athlete is awful when you're on a bad team, no matter how much money you make. So depending where you are in your career, it can land differently.
Yeah. Quickly on the new coach, Andre Tourigny. I hope I said that right. You can correct me if I didn't. You know, obviously a very good coach at, you know, junior levels and whatnot. What do you think he brings, thoughts on him and what he brings to this team at this particular time?
Well, I think he brings like a youthful energy and a relatability, because he's used to dealing with younger players and teaching, which in the NHL, it seems maybe obvious, but it's not. You don't get taught a lot in the NHL. Like, you're kind of there to be a finished product. You don't get to learn a whole bunch. He's good at that. It's what he's had to do at the junior level with younger, less developed players. It's what he's going to have to do with Arizona as well. And so I think you bring that kind of energy, enthusiasm, and approach to teaching and growing. And that's probably why it's the match for this team for the next several seasons.
Yeah, and not a playoff team. I think you would agree with me on that. But a team, if it's a successful season, we see growth, I guess, you know, from some of these guys.
You'll see their young players play better. You'll see a couple names you maybe weren't sure of or didn't even know. You're like, oh, this guy's an NHL player. And maybe some found assets in that regard. And a very successful draft lottery and a very high pick would be a good year for Arizona.
Opportunity in the desert. Thanks a lot, Johnny.